Hello, everyone. My name is Emma, and this is Learn From the Past, a channel where I geek out about cool history stuff, and you hopefully learn some cool history stuff. Let's get started. Today, we're continuing the Nellie Bly series with her record-breaking trip around the world. This is my second video in the Nellie Bly series. The first covered her famous Madhouse expose, which you can find here or in the description box below. After Bly came back from her stint in Blackwell's Lunatic Asylum, she was itching for another story. The New York World, with its dropping sales, was also in need of catchy headlines. Bly, who apparently came up with the idea sitting in bed the night before, pitched the idea of traveling around the world in 80 days in an imitation of Jules Verne's classic novel. Bly's editor was dubious, but when she showed him her proposed route, which was scheduled to be completed in just 75 days, he agreed to the story. Just one thing. He wanted a male reporter to go, since a man could travel without an escort. Bly threatened to take the story to another paper if the World didn't put her on the assignment. The story was tabled for over a year, until one day, out of the blue, her editor gave her the assignment, and Bly ran home to pack. Unbeknownst to Bly, just days after her departure, competing newspaper The New York Journal sent their reporter Elizabeth Bisland the other way in a race around the world. Bly only packed one dress, which she commissioned the night before she was to leave. A heavy travel dress that could stand months of wear. In her single, small suitcase, she packed a summer dress, a winter dress, some undergarments, and a jar of cold cream. With her itinerary still in the works, Bly boarded the steamship Augusta Victoria on November 14th, 1889 at 9:40 a.m. Her first stop? Paris. In Paris, she met up with Jules Verne and his wife to speak with them about her trip. Bly was very complimentary of the Vernes in her report. She seemed especially taken with Madame Verne, writing, quote, "With a smile on her soft, rosy lips, Madame Verne sat nursing the cat, which she stroked methodically with a dainty white hand, while her luminous black eyes moved alternately between her husband and myself. She was the most charming figure in that group around the wood fire. Imagine a youthful face with a spotless complexion, crowned with the whitest hair, dressed in smooth, soft folds on the top of a dainty head that is most beautifully poised on a pair of plump shoulders. Add to this face pretty red lips that opened disclose a pair of lovely teeth and large, bewitching black eyes, and you have but a faint picture of the beauty of Madame Verne." Unable to stay longer than a few hours, Bly caught a train from Amiens to Calais, France. Bly's next stop was Brindisi, Italy. The fog was so thick that she only caught a brief glimpse of the landscape, which she described as breathtaking. There was a cultural misunderstanding in Italy when Bly tried to give a coin to a small girl. Her father angrily told her not to take it. A nearby waiter smoothed over the incident. This wasn't the only time Bly's monolingualism was a hindrance. In Brindisi, Bly reboarded the steamship Victoria, much to her chagrin. She speaks very negatively about her experiences on the Victoria, stating that passengers and employees alike were very rude to her. This stopped for a while when a rumor went around that Bly was an eccentric American heiress. Before she disembarked, Bly received two different marriage proposals. Her next stop was Port Said, Egypt. The passengers were rowed ashore by locals with dinghies. Bly says that it was common practice for captains to stop halfway to shore and ask for payment for the trip. Bly's captain explained that many Englishmen and Americans who carried canes would simply beat off the captains once they reached shore without paying them. Bly writes of her admiration of the business tact of the locals. In Port Said, Bly traveled through the markets, buying a sun hat and speaking of the locals in outdated terms. She describes a niqabi woman as if she's never heard of a niqab before. After Port Said, the boat traveled through the Suez Canal. Bly notes happily that the addition of an electric lamp on the bow of the ship allowed the ship to continue its slow passage through the night. Thomas Edison had only patented the light bulb 10 years before. In Yemen, Bly was one of only a handful of passengers to attend this shore excursion because it was so hot. Bly notes the presence of British soldiers in Aden, Yemen. In 1889, when Bly visited, Yemen was still part of the Ottoman Empire, but Britain was looking at taking it over and had stationed a protective area around the port of South Aden. The next stop on Bly's cruise was Ceylon, Sri Lanka. Bly, having tried a curry dish on the ship, had decided that she didn't like it. But some of the more seasoned passengers convinced her to try it in Sri Lanka, where it was made correctly. She decided she loved curry when she tried it at a Sri Lankan restaurant. In Ceylon, Bly visited a Buddhist temple and met with the high priest. Her next stop was Colombo, Sri Lanka, where she stayed for 5 whole days due to a mix-up with the ship before boarding the Nepal and continuing on to Malaysia. They anchored in Penang, Malaysia, then also known as Prince of Wales Island. But their stay there was shortened by their extensive stay in Sri Lanka. After Sri Lanka, the ship moved on to Singapore. In Singapore, Bly saw lots of monkeys in the shops, including an orangutan, which she'd never seen before. Then, when her driver took them to his home for dinner, Bly saw his pet monkey, which she promptly bought from him. She named the monkey McGinty. Her next stop was Hong Kong. On the way to Hong Kong, the ship she was traveling on passed near enough to a monsoon that Bly could see it. Many of the passengers were seasick, and lots of the cabins flooded, including Bly's. Despite the monsoon, the ship reached Hong Kong 2 days ahead of schedule. Bly fell in love with the architecture of Hong Kong. She describes mountainside homes as gleaming white and castle-like. She compliments the geometric shapes and the integration into the mountainside. From Hong Kong, she needed to get to Japan as quickly as possible. When Bly inquired at the travel office about the quickest route, she was told for the first time about Elizabeth Bisland's competing trip. Apparently, Bisland had papers asking everyone to assist her in her trip. Bly had papers asking captains and conductors to be kind to her. In Hong Kong, Bly was also told that her ship was going to be stranded for 5 days, giving Bisland the win. So, Bly caught a different ship out of Hong Kong, the Oceanic. From there, she sailed on to Japan. Aboard the Oceanic, Bly's monkey, McGinty, attacked a stewardess, scratching her arm. Bly was forced to keep the monkey in her cabin from then on. The boat disembarked in Yokohama, Japan. Bly was immediately in love with the country. She notes its extreme cleanliness and the kindness of the people. Bly said that if her inner wanderer ever decided to settle, she'd want to settle in Japan. From Yokohama, the Oceanic set sail for the United States. The captain and the crew were all on board with making sure Bly won the race around the world. The band played Home Sweet Home, Hail Columbia, and The Girl I Left Behind Me in honor of Bly's projected success when they launched. And the chief engineer wrote, quote, "For Nellie Bly will win or die, January 20th, 1890. On the walls of the boiler room. Although plagued by bad weather all the way, the Oceanic docked in time. As they neared New York, the purser cried out that they left the bill of health behind in Yokohama. When Bly found out that that meant they wouldn't be able to disembark in New York for 2 weeks, she threatened suicide, prompting another search. The bill of health was located in the doctor's desk. Bly disembarked and boarded a tugboat toward shore. As she pulled away, the doctor called out that he'd forgotten to examine her tongue to see if she was healthy enough to re-enter the continent. Bly stuck her tongue out at him from the tugboat. The doctor laughed and let her go. Bly was afforded her own private car on the way back to New York, filled with flowers and cards from well-wishers. After she was settled, she went into the press car, which was filled with reporters who wanted scoops on her story. She gave interviews for hours. Everyone wanted to know about her dress, which had survived constant wear for 72 days. In Philadelphia, Bly transferred trains. At her final destination in Jersey City, Bly jumped off the train with 2 feet so that reporters could record the exact time that her trip ended. As she jumped, a cannon sounded and the crowd went wild. Bly traveled 21,740 miles around the world in 72 days, 6 hours, and 11 minutes. What made this so remarkable was how many competitors she beat to get it. She beat Elizabeth Bisland of the New York Journal, she beat fictional Phileas Fogg's record of 80 days, and she beat her own projected goal of 75 days. By the end of her journey, the entire country was rooting for her. Following her journey as the New York World provided maps and itineraries to its readers. When Bly surpassed her goal, the country celebrated with her. Thank you so much for watching. If you haven't seen the first video in this series, you can watch it here. My next video in 2 weeks will be about Bly's pro-workers' rights stance and the working class article she wrote. So be sure to subscribe and ring the bell to get notified about new videos so you don't miss any of it. Thanks again for watching, and remember, those who don't learn from the past are doomed to repeat it. So don't doom yourself. I'll see you next time. Bye.